Hi, and welcome to IT Lips episode 78. My name's Nicky Curtis, and joining me we have...
You've got Mark Moss this week.
Again, the sound guy, as he's become to know. So yeah, so you've seen Mark a few times now, and many podcasts. One of the ones we got quite a lot of feedback from was the SAN Essentials episode, where Mark took us through configuring EVA and going through concepts of SANs, something which I found quite interesting. It's not something I work with day to day. My next question, or your next question afterwards, was to really... looking at performance of SANs, we had lots of questions asking about iSCSI versus fibre, and you know, some conflicting information going on the forum. So what we plan to do in this episode is just take us through a tool called Iometer.
Yeah, we'll do some benchmark testing actually.
Yeah, so some benchmark testing using a tool called Iometer. So Mark's going to take us through that tool. And to do some testing, what Mark's going to do is we've got some SANs out there. We've got an EVA SAN, we've got an Equilogic SAN.
We've got an EVA SAN, we've got Fibre Channel, we've got iSCSI. Yeah, I mean, the last one that we done, it was a quick just show, you know, the basics of SANs, how to set it up. And I did say at the time that it was not optimised, it was badly configured, but just to prove it would work. And we were doing everything, if you remember, through the network connection, and we were doing everything over one network card.
Yeah.
We were doing a rooted iSCSI and not a normal iSCSI. So it was just showing that, simply how it could be done and how it would work. That is not how you would set it up in the real world.
Oh dear.
And not how you would do any kind of testing. So what I thought we'd do this time, because there's lots of feedback that I was saying over there, could we have some more info, is actually demo a proper setup. So we've got a proper iSCSI VLAN, completely isolated, proper fibre channel switches. And I thought for this one, I'd introduce a bit of VMware as well.
Yeah.
I think we haven't done any VMware at the moment.
No, we haven't touched on VMware Server at all. May have mentioned it, but yet to see it at IT-Lips.
So we'll show a little bit of VMware. I won't focus too much on VMware for this particular one, but we'll certainly do some more on VMware later on. Happy to do that. But at least it gives me the opportunity to be able to connect multiple disk subsystems and give people a taste of VMware, and we can start running a few tests and ask a few questions as well. So, where's the best place to start? I thought what we could possibly do is I spent a little bit of time last time with showing off an old EVA SAN. So I thought, well, let's mix it about a bit and show some other manufacturers. So I thought for this particular episode, I'd show a little bit about an Equilogic SAN. The Equilogic has been around a while. It's purely an iSCSI based SAN. So this one has been kind of optimized and brought onto the market purely as iSCSI. They don't do fibre channel at all. And it's not a bad little box, and very similar features.
Yeah, but I remember when we sort of started talking about Equilogic, and lots of people's comments on Equilogic was none too good. And then we looked at it and it found it performs quite well.
That's right, yeah. Originally, we had some people looking at it, and so we kind of semi-dismissed it a few years ago, saying, you know, iSCSI is a bit too new, and you know, you and I know that there's lots behind the scenes of iSCSI that you can get wrong that do make it struggle. But actually what we found with this particular piece of equipment, that if you set it up right and use all the right switches and everything else that we've spoken about, this box actually performs quite well.
Okay, that'd be interesting to see.
It's very easy, very scalable, very easy to buy another one and add it to it, and it grows. Mm-hmm. And when it grows, the performance almost doubles, actually. Every time you add a new box on it, it's quite linear the way it grows. So at least it shows everybody some different technology out there, which I think we've got people might want to see. So the Equilogic box, a bit like the EVA we spoke to before, is managed can be managed either with a web browser or this small little application.
Okay.
I'm just going to log on to the box. And we can bring that up.
Okay.
So it's very similar to other ones. It's got a menu down the left-hand side. All the options that you can do, and you can see this is actually a completely empty box with nothing on it whatsoever, so we can pretty much do what we like here. And this is slightly different to the EVA that we spoke about before. The EVA, if you remember, was a group of disks, and then on there we created a virtual disk, and then on the virtual disk we said what RAID level we wanted the disc to be, and you could mix and match RAID levels over the same set of discs.
And that's what I had problems with, yeah.
That's what you had problems with. So this one we should be okay with, because this one is actually a group of discs, and you set the RAID level on the group of discs. So if I just scroll down and select our box, which is...
How many discs have we got in this one, Mark?
So this one here, this is actually, you can see on the screen now, it's a picture of the box. So that's 16 discs.
16 of them.
So we've got 16 discs. All coupled together there, and if you can see up there, we're running RAID 50 on this particular box, and these are all SAS. So these are quite fast discs. They do a couple of models. They do a few models, but basically they're either SAS based or SATA based discs. And basically the systems are pretty much the same. It's the size of the discs that you can buy. But the chassis, the controllers are pretty much the same in all of them. It's just what discs that you want inside. Yep. On this particular one, you cannot mix SAS drives and SATA drives. So on the other model, you could mix and match discs in the same shelf. This is a slightly different architecture. So this, you typically buy a shelf full of SAS drives.
Uh-huh.
You can buy then buy a shelf of SATA drives and add it to the previous one, and you build up this array of discs, and you can then start moving things around between the discs. This is also very clever. Once you get beyond the first one and start having a mixture of discs, the actual subsystem will span the data across multiple shelves, multiple controllers, multiple discs, and if you remember from before, you get a better performance.
Yes.
It can also, if you've got different types of discs, from SAS discs to SATA drives, it can also, if you enable it, it can look at the profile of your servers and the I/O characteristics, and it can say, hold on a minute, you've put this disk on these high-speed, expensive disks, and I can see that actually you're not making full use of them. And it can actually move the disk off of the fast ones onto the slow ones in the background, and then release those fast ones to something else, or vice versa. It could see something on the slow disks, saying, well, actually, if you were on the faster disk, you could perform better. It will actually move them around. So there's some sort of features on this particular model that don't exist on others.
So in terms of price on the Echologic, a lot cheaper than the EVA, I imagine, is that?
These are always difficult. I don't find there's much in it.
Okay.
The time you spec them up with dual controllers and all of the disks and all the rest of it, it's very difficult to say. The other thing you've got at the moment that's been going on, especially during the recession, that different times of the year, we found that different manufacturers have kind of different pricing,
right,
or pricing discounts. So, you might see 10% off the list price of these, some you might see 30, 40, and same with other manufacturers. So the good thing I'll say about if you're looking at a SAN at the moment is actually try and play them off against one another. So even if you know the type of SAN that you're looking for, so even if it's an Echologic or HP, Left Hand, NetApps, get quotes from them all and then tell each one that you're actually looking at the others as well.
Yeah, I mean, just to give people out there an idea, what's the cost of this thing we're looking at, roughly, just ballpark?
I think this one's somewhere between 15-20k from memory with all of the controllers on it. But I would have to check. It's
all controllers, and that's...
Yeah, so this is the front that you're looking at. It's actually a pretty good picture of the front. All it is a bunch of discs on the front. If I click on the rear view, you'll see there that at the back we've got dual power supplies. In the middle, we've got the dual controllers, and you'll see each controller has got the gigabit connection on there. It's quite interactive.
And that's just going to a gigabit switch. And that there's no such thing as a storage gigabit switch, it's just a gigabit
This switch, is going to a gigabit switch. We are actually connected this up to a Cisco 3750, which is probably one of the best switches on the market for doing this kind of thing.
Okay.
Without going up to the chassis-based system. So obviously there's bigger systems out there, like Cisco do the chassis-based 6500 series and things like that. But this is a stackable switch. Not that cheap. I think they're around about £3,000-£3,500 a switch. These can do layer 3 routing, which we've spoken about in the past, about being able to route between VLANs.
Yeah.
They support all of the jumbo frames. You can see on that particular screen there, we've got the MTU size 9,000 bytes. So you can already see that this has been configured for jumbo frames rather than the default 1,500 bytes. And also on the particular Cisco switch, they've got, you know, all the flow control, non-blocking, lots of memory, good processing power. So it really is a good switch. You know, you'd expect if it was to be doing routing and all the rest of it, but not the cheapest switch on the market. And you can get cheaper ones to do this, but we're actually connected to a good switch here. You know, we're going to try and demo some I/O performance. So I think it's only fair. Yeah. If I've got a proper SAN switch, then I put a proper iSCSI switch in the background. We're not doing justice, really. But you can see there, you know, multiple controllers. There's two controllers there, dual power supplies, a pretty resilient box. And I'll just have a quick flick around just so that people can see a few things on there. It's being well monitored there, so as you'd expect to see on pretty much any
SAN. On SAN, it costs $15,000.
You'd expect to see, you know, all the temperatures, so anything wrong with it, fan speeds, how it's going, all the rest of it. You know, you'd want to make sure everything's okay. You can see there we've got the two controllers. Controller one is the active controller at the moment. Yep. And if we go along there, you can see the disks. So we've got 16 disks, and you can see two of them are hot spares. So we're actually only using 14 spindles, and two of them are hot spares. You can configure this so it would use all of them if you wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
It's pros and cons. At the minute, we've only got the 136. So what does that? I'm trying to think what size that is when it's not formatted. It'd be probably the 146 drives, isn't it? Yeah. So you can see we got the not too large, but they are the SAS-based ones. And there's the controllers we're looking at there. So you can see they're all up, all running at gigabit, all with jumbo frames enabled.
So what, three? I thought we only had two. I was one, a management one or something.
On the controllers,
I'm just looking at the three. You've got Ethernet 0, 1, 2.
Yeah, each of the controllers, if I go back to the picture,
there's two
vertical controllers there,
uh-huh,
and each one's got three ports on it. You would typically cross wire this, and often you would have a couple of switches and you would cross wire it so that one switch went to both controllers. So if a switch did foul, you can carry on. We've only got this up to one switch at the moment, but it's certainly all of those six ports are enabled. So if a controller was to foul, it would automatically carry on the other one.
Okay.
So we've actually got into this particular model 3 gig of throughput into here,
mm-hmm,
so no shortage of bandwidth.
No one connected.
And they're all connected. So, a little bit of a recap for us, really. I think there is first of all, we need to do is create a volume so that we can present this to a server. So
these are just, if like 16 new disks, there's nothing on them.
Nothing on them at all. No, 16 disks, 14 of them configured in RAID 50. You can do RAID 5 or RAID 10. RAID 50 is a good compromise between fault tolerance and performance. Mm-hmm. So it's a sort of a halfway house between them all. So first thing we need to do is create a volume.
Yep.
So we'll create a volume. I'm going to call this, I guess we're going to present this to the ESX server. So I'll call it ESX, which is our VMware server. I'm going to call it lab vol.
It's got to have Echologic somewhere in there, or some kind of identifier.
We can put Echologic in there if you want. We could call that at the beginning.
Just when we present it, otherwise I'll get confused, Mark. I'm not the brightest, especially this time of night.
Echologic lab vol one.
Yep.
So this is our test server that we've got there. So you can see there, telling us the available space. So, okay, how large do we want this? So let's make a reasonable size here, make it something worthwhile. I think in the past we've spoken about thin provisioning. This is where I can say, okay, I'm going to tell the operating system, so this is VMware, that I've got a 250 gig volume, but I'm going to say, well, actually, how much of this volume am I actually going to consume on
I suppose
server?
Can you expand volumes on VMware?
Yes, on the new version. On the previous one, it was a little bit tricky. So, actually, let's do this, actually, while we've got it in front of us. Let's say, well, actually, I don't know, oops, what was that, 70 was that? Mm-hmm. So what we'll actually do, we'll tell VMware it's got 250 gig, and when we go into that you'll see that, but actually you can see from here, actually it's only going to consume 70 gig of disk space on the actual SAM. No problem with doing this, the only thing you have to remember is you can overcommit the storage.
Yeah, you need some decent monitoring going on as well.
Exactly. So if we've only got 150 gig and then you started creating, you know, 50 of these volumes or whatever it is, you would actually be advertising more storage than you've got, and you would need to make sure that you're monitoring. So this is now saying, okay.
So I'm going to stop you just a minute though. It's slightly off topic, but it's all linked with SAM. I suppose with this deduke in there, that's when thin provisioning could actually tell the truth.
Yes.
Almost. So they, yeah. I can see those two sort of working together.
Yes, they do, yes. Yeah. So, yes, there's an overlap between thin provisioning and deduplication. Deduplication actually deletes duplicate blocks off the disk. Thin provisioning doesn't delete anything.
Yeah, but they sort of work really nice in combination, don't they?
Yes.
So you can see, yeah.
Yes, so with a mixture of the two, you can get very efficient
storage. It sort of, to me, it justifies thin provisioning, because I was having troubles in the last episode, didn't it?
Yes, so that they work hand in hand. Deduplication is really, this box can't do it, but it's really what virtualization is crying out for, especially if you're starting doing things like VDI, which we touched on as well, when you want to start putting multiple copies of the same operating system to be able to dedupe that. So what this is saying now is, okay, it's a bit like the previous EVAs we've looked at, saying, okay, I'm going to create this disk for you. Who do you want to be able to access this? So you've got different options here. CHAP is basically, you can set up a username and password, so I can go into the initiator, the operating system, and type in a username and password. I can actually say, well, only limit it to the source IP address of where it's coming from, or what we can use is the iSCSI initiator name, which is the IQN, which you might have remembered before, it's a bit like the worldwide name on Fiber Channel, you have it on IQN on iSCSI. A lot of people use username and passwords because it's, you know, you have to know that. You could, if you put an IP address, you know, change the IP address to another server and gain access to it. So, you know, and same with the IQN. If you knew the IQN, you could copy it, turn the other server off and see the disk. So often on iSCSI, you use username and password. But I'm going to stick to what we've been talking about in the past, and I'm going to use the iSCSI initiator name. So the first thing I need to know is obviously what the name is. And you remember from your Windows 1 and iSCSI, we went in there and found it. So down the bottom here, I've already got loaded up, is the...
Well, VMware.
VMware console. So this is Virtual Center, and we'll go into this in a lot more detail in a future episode, but this is VMware. So down the left-hand side, we've got all of the servers. The one I'm interested in is this server called ESX Lab 1. Mm-hmm. And there's all different features on here, but I've actually got it open at the configuration tab. There's lots of tabs, I'll have a quick flick around for you while we're here. So you can see a little bit of a summary of this particular host.
Process as well.
You can see it's a dual processor, quad core, so it's a reasonable spec, and we've got 24 gig of RAM in this box, and it's got a number of disks already being presented to it, and it's got lots of machines already running, so it's a fairly new server, a reasonable spec, so it'd be quite good for us to run some tests on.
What is that, Blade?
Yes, a Blade, yes, BL460 Blade. So we're going to the configuration, there's lots of things in here we can configure. The one that I'm interested in is the storage adapters and the storage. So on VMware, you can see that we've currently got some Fiber Channel, 4 gig. Mm-hmm. And we've got two Fiber Channel cards. Now these are physical cards that are in the server. And what you'll see if we look at the top is actually, the iSCSI is actually software based.
Yeah.
I think we touched on the past, the difference between hardware based, software based, and TCP offload engines and iSCSI cards and all the rest, host bus adapters. There's pros and cons about each of them, but what we've all found is that the VMware software adapter does work really well. So it's this is really a time that, in, that you need to put in a physical host bus adapter. But what you can probably see there is the IQN name.
Yeah.
Yeah. So if I open that up, you can see the IQN name there. So I'm just going to try and copy that. And then if I go back to my Equalogic, paste that in there. So hopefully I've got it all. We'll soon find out. So I'm going to say this disk can be seen by a server with that, that identity. Finish.
So, and we're presenting to the host, not the VMs here, aren't we?
That's right. We're going to do this to the host, so the virtual machines inside there will be accessing it through the host, not unlike what you did when you presented it direct. So this is to give it a good performance, and then we can treat all the disks the same.
Exact same, yeah.
Oops, excuse me. So we can now see our disk. You can see there exactly how we've configured it. Normal tabs access, you can see the information we just keyed in. Snapshots, if we want to make a copy of this disk, we can create a snapshot instantly. Same as all the other ones, and then present it. We can set up schedules for snapshots on a regular basis, every 5 minutes, every hour, we can take copies of that volume. So what we need to do now is to go back to our VMware server, and now we need to tell VMware to go and find that disk or that volume. So what you can see here, you probably recognize these addresses from previous episodes. These were the iSCSI to fiber channel gateways that we were using on the EVA. So they're still available. And we are actually, the 172.27.30 is the iSCSI VLAN, and we are actually on the iSCSI VLAN. So this is not routing through anything else, this is straight on to the iSCSI VLAN. So I'm going to add in to that list, we've done the iSCSI gateway previously, I'm going to add in the Equalogic box, and the Equalogic box is 172.27.30.3, and if you remember, the port for iSCSI is 3260.
Okay.
And here you can see the chap. If we wanted to use the username and password that was on the iSCSI box, but we could use that. But I'm going to keep this nice and simple for this demo and not worry about that. So we're just going to add that to the list. Just wait a few seconds, that should appear in the list. What you might just see in the background on the left hand side is you can see the VMware server in the background runs these schedules and these tasks. So every time you make a change, it goes off and then processes it and then comes back. So you can see now it's now happy with that, it's added it to the list. So if we go on to the what it's discovered, you can see on the left hand side the different ports, you can see all the iSCSI devices that it's found. The iSCSI gateway, and then you can see at the bottom, lo and behold, it's found the Equalogic box.
Yep.
So the next thing we need to do is if we scan the adapter, it's already said you've made changes, I suggest you rescan anyway, so we'll say scan that adapter. So it'll take just a few seconds to go up and have a look what it can see. And I think it just at the bottom there, if I scroll down,
completed.
You can just see it popped onto that list.
Yep.
You can see the Equalogic disk, Equalogic iSCSI disk. And you can see there, LUN ID disk, 250 gig. So that marries up now if we go back to the disk. As you can see, we presented it as 250 gig. It's actually only consuming 70 gig. But actually, when you go into VMware, VMware has absolutely no idea. Yeah, so that's in provisioning. So you can see there straight away. The next thing we need to do is just quickly on here, we need to add that disk in. It's a bit like going into Disk Manager onto Windows, adding the disk in and formatting it.
Okay.
Yeah. So we just need to add that one in. So we should. Add storage. Gonna add a disk. And it's saying, okay, this is what I can see. So we want the Echologic disk. Add the Echologic disk in, 250 gig, long zero. Enter a name, so let's give it some names so we can recognize them when we're doing some testing. Echologic Lab, what do we call it? Lab 401. We're trying to make it marry.
Yeah.
It makes it easier when you're kind of troubleshooting. And this is now saying on VMware, you can actually say when it writes to the disk is what size blocks it's using on the disk. Now, obviously, because it is optimized for virtualization, typically the files are going to be very large files.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the bigger chunks you can write to a disk in, the more efficient it is. And this is a bit like when you're doing a Windows format, you know, rather than doing the default format next, and you get 4K blocks normally by default. You know, if you take a bit of time and look at it, you can actually change that. Typically,
yeah.
And you're doing large databases, you're doing like 64K blocks, so that it's less IO. But
what are the options we've got in VMware? What's it? LIMP 256.
Well, 1 meg blocks is the smallest. Yeah. So which means the largest file that it can create is 256 gig, which is a reasonable size. But if you wanted a really large, like 2 terabyte volume, then it would recommend, or it wouldn't let you create anything less than 8 meg. That gives you the maximum sizes that you can go up to. So I could select 8 meg blocks and then just create a small disk. But the disk would be consumed in 8 megabyte chunks.
It reminds me of when you dealt with FAT, you know, and your partition sizes got bigger.
That's right.
You know, your block sizes got bigger, didn't
they?
That's
right, yeah. Every time you wrote a file to the disk, it was these big blocks. It's exactly the same principle. So, you know, if you want to be more storage or disk efficient, you would use smaller blocks.
Yeah.
But obviously, if you're going to do a big file system, you know, every time it writes 8 megabytes, there's going to be 8 IOs on a 1 meg block. Against, you know, if it's an 8 meg in blocks, is 1 IO.
Yeah.
So you can see by getting the right system, but it's a trade-off between IO and you know, wastage or usage on the rest of it. We'll keep this simple. We're only going to make small volumes here, so we'll keep it on 1 meg. They click finish, and you'll see down at the bottom that will go off and create that, and it's already added it to the list. That's the wrong one. That's the other ice column. It's added it to the list now. So at the bottom there, we can see the Echologic name. So we now can see an Echologic volume. So this is really high-level basics. We can do another episode and go into all of this in a lot more detail. But that's just showing you just a different kind of operating system, the same principles as we did before.
Mm-hmm.
The iSCSI initiator, put in the iSCSI target, go into the target, define your volume and present it to the initiator.
I mean, it's all really logical stuff, really, isn't it? You know,
once you've done it on one and you've seen it a couple of times, they all follow the same kind of principle, really, so it's not that bad at all. So what we'll do now, I've got over here on under the IT Idiots folder, I've got this virtual machine. You're used to Hyper-V. This is just on VMware. And I'm just going to edit the properties of this particular machine. You can see how we've got it configured. I've got an existing hard drive, and I'm going to add in some more hard drives so we can run some tests. So I'll select a hard drive and create a new virtual disk. So create 15 gigs should be enough. And now the data stores, each of those volumes that we created are known as data stores within VMware. So basically, where are you going to store your data? Yeah. So I'm going to do a selection here. So we will do our Echologic volume, the one we've just done there. So we'll select that. So I'm going to create a 15 gigabyte virtual disk, and it's going to store it on the iSCSI Equalogic volume. It's asking me what virtual SCSI ID, so we'll just go next with the next one. And finish to that. Mission that should create that one. And I'm going to add one more. And I'm going to pick a 5-channel disk as well.
Like we're looking at the last step set, like the creative. In fact, the same one, really.
Yeah.
Well, it's from the same sound.
From the same sound. What you also see here, you've also got the thin provisioning. And typically, if you've got a thin provisioned volume like we created,
you don't want to double that, do you?
Well, often you do. Often you can get carried away here because you may not be using all of the disk in the operating system. So if you thin provision at that level and then thin provision underneath it, they kind of complement one another.
I need to draw that on the whiteboard.
Maybe for a future one we'll get that one out to explain it. But typically for thin provisioning to work, you ideally need to have thin provision to be supported all the way. Otherwise, if I created a 15 gig file and I didn't click thin provisioning, this is going to go and create 15 gig.
Oh, okay, right, I see.
Okay, so this will create 15 gig if I don't do thin provisioning.
Yeah.
And I've thin provisioned a volume of 70
gig. Scrub the whiteboard. Yeah, got it.
You with it?
Yeah.
So the minute I've done the fifth one of these, that's 75 gig, is that right?
That
maths are right, so that'd be 75, and my volume's only 70. I've already started now to use up more space.
Yeah.
So to make thin provisioning work, you would need to thin provision here to complement the underneath.
How big was the volume? It's 150, wasn't it?
We 250.
250, so if you stuck 250 on there and say, allocate thin provisioning, that would work, but if you didn't,
that's when you're going to get issues out of disk space. Yeah, got it now.
But once I put 250 in there and didn't do thin provisioning, that entire volume that I created before with one system on it, even because it would consume, even though I've said thin provision up to 70, if you can go to 250, it would consume all the space. So I could put 250 in here, thin provision it, create another one at 250 and thin provision it, and then they would not use any more than that 70 gigabytes. Then I could create another 250 gig volume on the Equalogic and present that to another server.
Mm-hmm.
So that's 500 gig out of my 250. And as long as I thin provisioned the volumes on that, then it all works. The minute I don't thin provision this, it will start to consume the disk space. For this, for our demo, it doesn't matter whether we thin provision or not. I'm not going to, so it does create a 15 gig file.
We said 75 anyway, isn't it?
So it's within the 70 or 75. It's also for performance reasons because there's a slight minimal overhead as it fills up the space. It has to allocate more space. I mean, I think it's not noticeable, but to make it all fair, we'll not do any thin provisioning at this level. So now we've got our three disks. I'm just going to say okay to that. That should go off and process that down the bottom. At least it's saying reconfiguring. And that's done that. I'm just going to double check so everybody can see. So we've got our hard disk one. We can see up there is an iSCSI volume, which is actually on a HP EVA. We've got hard disk two, which is an iSCSI volume on an Equalogic.
Yep.
And we've got hard disk three, is another iSCSI level one. So we just need to double check all of these. I think I may have just got that one slightly wrong on there, so I'm just going to remove that one and add in.
You wanted the fiber one?
Yeah, I think I selected the wrong one. I wasn't watching there, so I'll play it back and have a look what I did wrong.
Or you can post to the forum what we did wrong, because there ain't going to edit it. Or Sufe ain't going to edit it.
I think it's as you say when you're kind of chatting and all the rest of it. I want to do that one there, get that file.
Dodgy naming convention, I would say.
I think, yeah, a good idea. I mean, this is a lab, so you can put something like FC at the beginning, or iSCSI, a bit like you were saying at the beginning, so that you actually know what you're dealing with. Good job I double-checked there.
I see everything got right to the end, and that would have been another one to add to the list.
So let's go and double-check again. So, EVA, lab poll 5, Ecologic, and C drives on there as well. Okay. So that's our one machine now with those discs.
I noticed it's only got 256 memory. Do we need to up that?
I don't think we need to, but if you want to...
No, I just thought it might... I don't know what it is. What is it? Is it XP?
It's a Windows XP.
XP,
no, so it's a 2003 server. Let's not mess around. This is VMware, not Hyper-V. So
hey!
It will only use what it needs. Anyway.
Hey, by the time this is out, Hyper-V might be doing the same.
There you go, 512. Look at that. Ease of changing memory. Just like that. Click of a button.
It switched off, though. I can do that.
Just turn it on. And then while it's turning on, we quickly open up the console. So this is our machine now. Our virtual hardware is now being switched on. You should see it start to power up. Normally it doesn't take too long. Normally much quicker than powering up a normal...
I thought you were going to say Hyper-V then.
It crossed my mind, but I thought I'd given you too much there. I mean, that was seconds really,
that was
wasn't
pretty
it,
quick,
to,
yeah.
To boot up the hardware, load up Windows. I mean, that's pretty quick, isn't it?
And what's so, that's on the iSCSI stand, the system
that's partition? That's booting off the iSCSI disk.
Yeah.
So, you can see the speed at which that loaded up. There's not much on this server.
Okay, music.
So we'll log on, so we'll just prove here, going to Disk Manager. Just check we can see all the disks and they're all formatted. So there we go.
There we go, trying something.
It's found the disks, which is good.
Yeah, of course I was thinking, oh god, we've got to muck around with the iSCSI target thing, but of course we don't because it's presented to the host machine, isn't it? So to the VM it's just a disk.
So all of these disks are presented to the host ESX server and then we're just using up 15 gig virtual disks. So they're all virtual disks but all on different underlying disk subsystems or different protocols connecting them. So, can you remember which one was what now?
The bottom one was... is there any way of finding out if you right click? Oh no, that information won't get punched through that far, will it?
No, what you can do, if you check on here, if you had to property this, you can see that's target ID 2, line 0. And if you go on the other one, target ID 1 and 0. So they've got different target IDs. And if you can't remember, you can always go back to the settings and you could look up the disk. Should tell you, there it is, sorry, SCSI. So that's one, and that's the Ecologic, so one is the Ecologic,
two,
and two is the EVA, so you can always
that's that's the fiber one,
So one is Ecologic, oops, sorry, new partition. Partition. Oh, E for Ecologic. How about that?
There you go.
Sounds good, doesn't it?
I know what's coming up as well.
So I'm going to make this quite large, give it something more realistic. It almost looks like we planned this.
It does, doesn't it? Part of me is overthinking now, really. Cause it's,
not F. No, that sounds just.
Yeah, but it's F for 5 and you've got E for Ecologic. It's not truly matched, is it?
Okay.
Because it should be I for iSCSI, really. Or it should be E for Ecologic and H for HP. Sorry for poo-pooing it all, but...
Oh, hey, okay, go on, there you go.
No, don't take it in. I was just trying to be difficult.
I'm going to leave it as F for 5
minutes,
because the other one at the top is actually on HP as well, so we'll have F for 5 channel. I'm just going to put in there, FC for 5 channel.
Or French Connection.
Oh, a good sign. Cancelled due to internal error.
I've seen that, you know, when you did with SANS before, you know.
With SANS?
Well, when you write, you create a new one and present it, whenever someone's created a new one, often I right-click format and it fails the first time. I don't know if it's a speed thing or... But I ain't making that up.
Yeah, it's going there. I mean, it's unusual. Oh, it's because we booted it up. Often you can present the disk faster than the operating system can detect it. So anyway, we've got them there now, Ecologic and Fibre Channel. I'll just minimise that. So what my thoughts were now then, is we can actually do some tests now to show everybody the difference between the systems and whether there is actually a difference, actually. It's more to the point. So I tend to use this iometer program.
Yeah, this is something I tried to look into a few months back again. Iometer, I think it's Intel-based, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And again, if you Google it, there's loads of information on it, none of which is helpful.
Well, I've set up some standard tests to make it a bit easier for us.
Uh-huh.
The ones that we tend to do. So basically, we can select whichever disk we want to run a test on, so we can do the C drive.
Yeah, because I'm interested in what kind of things we're testing. What's the typical kind of things
you would... In fact, I've got some templates loaded, so let me open up the templates rather than selecting from that list.
Okay.
Okay, so what we'll do here is we can do throughput. So this will be quite good to show where bottlenecks are. So maximum throughput, 100% read. So all we're going to be doing now is reading from the disk. There'll be no writing to the disk whatsoever. Okay. We're just going to do some tests now on the C drive. See how fast can we read from the disk. So if we go to the results now.
Oh, this is actually doing it, is it?
Yeah, so okay. That's just going to read now. I think it was the C drive we picked, which was the iSCSI disk on the Fibre Channel SAM. The thing you can see there, a couple of things, is obviously the I.O. is quite high there, 33,480 I.O.s. And you can see megabytes per second, 108, which is pretty much maxed out gigabit. Now, if you've got MPIO loaded,
mm-hmm.
and MPIO working well. Now MPIO on this is being done at the ESX layer. So on the virtual machines you don't need to install any MPIO, sure, yeah. Because all the MPIO is being handled by the ESX. Although I always have my reservations with ESX on how it handles MPIO.
Oh, so do I.
And it's round robin. But that's showing there, that's pretty much maxed out gigabit, 108 meg. I think it's maxed out gigabit as fast as it can read.
So on this one, we're saying IOPS is 3,500.
3,500 IOPS. But the limitation here is probably not the disk subsystem. What we're looking at here is the link between... Mm-hmm.
That's max.
It is a gigabit and it's maxed out. So you know, the way to improve that is multiple gigabits or anything like that. So that's a quick test on that one there. So that's the C drive. Now if we go back now and select the fibre channel disk, and we do exactly the same test. Let's see if there's any difference. Yeah.
We can, I reckon there is.
Kick that off. I'm not sure. I click start, is that... not
changing, is that?
That's not changing, is it? It's not. We'll not kick that off. The I select the test. Open the test. Let's start again. These targets.
That's all right.
A clear option. I'm just trying to see if it's a clear the results page, because that's the results from before, isn't it?
Just close it and open it.
That's it.
I reckon that's taken all
from
there.
Ah, again. Okay. Got them all now. Let's not do them all. Okay, we just want to do just to read them, so just to get this going. But it takes sometimes a few minutes.
Yeah, because I suppose he's winning at the moment, and it's not what I would expect.
No, but it can show you that actually. It's, you know, it's not always as bad as you may expect. There are often other things, you know, that are dictating it. So, you know, that's levelling out. It's actually slightly less, isn't it?
Yeah.
So what's the difference? This is fibre channel. This is fibre channel at 2 gig. The other one was iSCSI. Running at 1 gig, it may be running actually at 2 gig. I would need to check. I think the ESX box actually has got 2 1 gig connections, so it may be running at 2 gig with MPIO. Fibre channel doesn't use frames that are 9k, and it uses frames that are 2k. So it could be that because we're using jumbo frames and every packet is coming at 9k instead of 2k. We're doing a big read here, aren't we? Mm-hmm. Big chunks of data, megabytes. So we're saying, you know, how fast can you get it to me? So I'm sending this over, you know, nice cuzzy in 9K chunks instead of 2K chunks. So the fibre channel, in theory, has got to work 4 times harder.
Yeah.
Because every 4 packets in fibre channel is roughly 1 packet in jumbo frames, nice cuzzy. So this, you know, compared with what we did last time when we were doing it, when it didn't perform very well, you know, when we copied the file. We kicked off the iSCSI file with about 3 or 4 gigabytes from what I remember, or a couple of gig, wasn't it? And then we chatted for a few seconds, and then we kicked off the fibre channel, and the fibre channel blitzed it, didn't it? So this is pretty much the same test as we were doing then, but a bit more scientific. And we've actually shown, we've actually, the same set of disks as before, we've reversed it. We're actually saying iSCSI is now faster than the fibre channel, which has gone to show, actually, with the right switch, the right settings, the right setup, iSCSI can perform just as fast or faster than fibre channel.
Mm-hmm.
But configured badly, as we had it before, it doesn't perform very well at all. So it's a good example there. So that's, we can stop that one. And then, that they're both, the C drive and the F drive are actually on the same sound. They're actually the same set of discs, so in theory you say they should be the same, but it just shows you that, you know, the communication between the server and the SAN can have a huge difference there. So we do the one more test at the end there. If we select the Echologic box, that is want me to reset everything again, see if it will do it without me resetting everything. No, it's going to have a reset, that's not a problem. Let's quickly reset.
I suppose the previous one was running the OS from it, that might have a bit of impact on that. But it's not doing anything this server, is it?
No. So let's do the Echologic one now. So we're going to select the Echologic box.
Seems to be a win. That's my prediction. My prediction was fibre was going to win, but
You're not doing very well so far.
Not at all, no. But this is your episode, isn't that doing me this?
This is no idea. I'm not out to say one thing or another. I'm just going to show to everybody that what you may expect and what you actually get are not necessarily the same. So if anything, you're proving that theory.
I'm backing it up, so yeah.
I don't think you set out, well, I don't know, did you set out to plan that or... But I think it's good. It's good to show everybody that there's so many variables here that you know, you don't always get what you expect.
Yeah.
And you should run these kind of tests to prove that everything is working correctly. Don't just assume it is working correctly. So if we kick this one off then, so this is on the Echologic box.
Yep.
And your prediction is this is going to win.
This is going to win with about 3,600. Okay.
There we go. You've got 100% success rate of being wrong every time.
I have, haven't I? Yeah, so... What's going on there then? What's interesting about EVA in this one then?
The EVA has got 66 discs.
Oh, okay, yeah. Yeah, next one. Well, yeah, if I knew that...
I told you at the beginning.
I can't remember all the combinations.
So this is perfect. We've done exactly the same test, which is a read-only test. We're not actually writing to the disc at all. We're just saying, how fast can I read off those discs? So we've worked out that iSCSI, configured correctly, is as fast or faster than Fibre Channel.
Yeah.
However, we've also proven that actually, if you haven't got enough spindles and discs to actually get the data off fast enough, you can see the Echologic is only running at half the speed.
Yeah.
Which isn't bad.
It's only got less than half the discs.
And the other one's got 66 discs.
So you said if you get two Echologics, that would double that.
It probably would. You'd probably find if you put two on there, that would probably go up near the 100 mark. Yeah. So, let's give you a good example. We can mix this up a bit now, I think. We've given a good idea for reading. Well, what about if we do some... You know, typical real world.
Yeah, that's
read and write, because that's, you know, there's no real sound that just does 100% maxed out read. So if we reset again, so any particular one you want to try on? Which one would you like to go for first then as the benchmark for the rest?
We'll go Fibre Channel.
Fibre Channel,
because that's got to be
Fibre Channel. Okay,
that's got to be good for some. I just don't know, because I'm thinking random writes and stuff, but that makes absolutely no difference, does it? Because the only difference is how the data gets to the disk system, isn't it? I mean, the writing to the disks.
So, we've got this one here called Real Life, which is random read and random write. So it's going to run that one on that disk. So this is typical... reading and writing, hammering your sound. Let's get a benchmark from this one then. So this is giving it a lot of work to do here now. So we're going to read, write, random all over the place. So you can see once you start doing lots of read and write, the performance drops right down. This also shows our manufacturers and distort figures. Yeah. Maximum megabytes per second total IOs. Depending on what figures you choose, if it's all read, all write, and all the rest of it, you'll get those wonderful figures that they say. When you start hammering it like we are now by reading and writing and all the rest of it, you can see it starts to struggle now. You can see response times there as well. We just concentrate on the top two there. See, all of a sudden the performance has dropped right off, hasn't it? It's like, that was phenomenal.
Which one of these would you believe? Because the only thing I have with IOPS at the moment is running MapTool, the MapTool. And the MapTool I ran came up with, these 25 servers require 856 IOPS.
Yes.
So what am I comparing against, this Real Life thing?
That top one.
But this is a good template, that Real Life test.
This is a reasonable template. It might be slightly on the hard side, so this is probably erring on the side of caution and actually being a bit harder than it would do in real life. But this you wouldn't go far wrong by using this. It, you know, you probably find it slightly better. But you can see here that if you, you know, if you're really hammering your sand by reading and writing, random IOs all over the place, it's not sequential, mm-hmm. it's, you know, all the disks are having to do a lot of work, all of a sudden you can see actually all I'm getting there is roughly, what was that, 400 IOPS?
Yeah.
And you're saying all of a sudden I've got to use map tool, I need 900, 800 IOPS. All of a sudden this might not be enough. Mm-hmm. This configuration may not be enough to work satisfactorily for you. So that's, can you remember that, 400 and 3 megabytes, and we'll do some tests on the others and we can see where we get to the other ones. So I'll stop that one.
So 5 to 400, I was trying to think.
Yeah, so hopefully people looking at this will find this useful and to prove that when they don't get their SANs, they should run a tool like this to actually confirm that it's, you know, working as they think it is. So that was the fibre channel one. Yeah. So we'll go back. What one do you want to use next?
Equilogic.
And is this going to be faster or slower? What are you going for?
Just trying to think how the network would affect, because we're not, the writes are...
I mean, this is really hard, random read writes. This is probably the worst case scenario for any disk subsystem, so it's really stressing it.
Well, based upon the amount of disks, then the fibre's got to win.
Is that what you're going for?
Yeah, that's what I'm going for.
Ready?
Yeah.
Let's go. Okay. Kick that off.
We got an explicit tag, haven't we, you shit?
So what are we seeing there? This is the Equilogic, was it, you picked?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
It's doing quite well, actually, isn't it?
It's not doing too bad. I wouldn't buy it.
So, for doing 100% read and maximum throughput, it wasn't great, was it, really? It was a bit behind the fibre channel on the rest of them, but all of a sudden, we're now saying, well, hold on a minute, I want you to read and write all over the place at the same time and all the rest of it. Now, obviously, the architecture in the Equilogic box is geared up for that kind of operation.
Yeah, so this is like the controller in the Equilogic box. Because what I'm trying to marry up is, the only thing that's different is the network, but it's not, is it?
Yeah, so this...
So EVA, is that an old piece of crap, old piece of junk?
It's an old EVA.
Okay.
It's an old EVA, it might have 66 disks. And fine, if I'm telling it to read ID sequentially, it's going to read them off very quickly. There's a lot of spindles. But if I'm going to say, right, now randomly read and write over all of the disks, it's struggling.
So that would do for me 25 servers, that one. Equilogic. Fine. There we go.
So if you had bought that particular model of EVA, yes, it's an old one and new ones are a lot faster than that. But that's, you know, you might say, well, I've got this old EVA, actually, fibre channel, 66 disks,
yeah.
You'd go for that every time, wouldn't you? Without running any tests, you'd be saying it's not running very well. Why is that? It doesn't make sense. And then someone else has gone and bought an Equilogic box with 14 disks working on it, and all of a sudden they've got exactly the IOPS that you require for doing a typical read-write. Yeah.
Cool, it'd be really interesting to run this on my home server now. I want to see what IOPS my home server's getting.
So there's only one left to do now, really, and you've got...
Only one left for me to get wrong, really, isn't there?
So we'll stop that one then, and the last one we've got left to do.
This is going to be the fastest. Absolutely the fastest.
Are you just deliberately trying to get it wrong now?
No, because the one on the C drive was faster before, wasn't it, than the Equilogic?
So we were doing just the... intense read write. Okay.
Yeah.
And you think this is going to be the fastest of the lot?
Final answer.
Final answer. For £1 million. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Are you ready?
Faster. And it's the slowest, isn't it?
And I would have said it would have been the slowest, actually. Why would I say that was the best in the slowest?
Because it's part of your job, mate, that's why. I'm not meant to know this, guys.
So that's the worst of the lot. And why is it the worst of the lot? Because it's on the same EVA as Fibre Channel. You already see the Fibre Channel one didn't perform very well when we're doing band and read and writes. So this is the same EVA. I wouldn't expect it to do very well.
Yeah, it was the controller, Dan. You gave not me, told that, me that.
I told you that. Not only that, we're not talking to it in Fibre Channel. It's a Fibre Channel sound. We're actually talking to it in iSCSI as well. So it should be even worse because we're going from iSCSI to Fibre Channel to a disc. So this should be the worst of the lot. So,
only a fool really would say this would be the fastest.
Do you guys know that Mark's my manager? You know. But, no, cool.
So I think, you know, from those kind of quick tests there, I think what we've shown, and it's good putting it on VMware, is because we can flip between the disks very easily, and it's the same server, same disks, or same tests, and that's a fair test.
Yeah.
On two SANs using different protocols. And what I'm hoping to show everybody, and you as well, how easy it is to guess wrong. Pick the wrong one.
Absolutely. I'm not used to being dummy in these ITS episodes, you know. It's not working for me. It's not working.
But, hopefully that's useful to everybody anyway.
Yeah, no, that's good.
And what we'll do for future episodes, I think we've chatted for quite a while for this one. I hope people find it entertaining as well. Next time maybe we'll do a bit of zoning and other things like that to kind of complete the picture. And then as we've already touched on VMware, we'll do a session on VMware and talk to that in a lot more detail and show you some of the features around that. But is that enough for now, or do you have any other questions?
I think that's it, eh? No, I just want to use I went to my little servers at home to see what they give me, because that'd be really interesting. You know those profiles you had, the real life ones? Did we create them? You created them, or is it
we created them.
Okay.
So we can copy them off anyway. So. Cool. But then we found that they are good ones for doing proper tests and get proper figures. And if you use those profiles and use those figures, you won't go wrong on your hardware.
Cool.
Yep. Excellent. And with that,
that's another episode.
Okay.
So, until next time, if there is one. See ya. Bye.
Bye.
Cool.